Hello, this is Athena Lemon from the Wolbachia Project. Today, we're going to start talking about what could be the most rewarding part of the project, bioinformatics. Bioinformatics refers to whenever we analyze any complex biological data with the help of a computer. In our case, we're going to be analyzing the data that we amplified during the PCR lab. Let's remember that we amplified the arthropod's barcoding region from the gene cytochrome oxidase 1, or CO1, found in the arthropod's mitochondria. We also amplified some Wolbachia DNA if Wolbachia was present. By looking at our gel, we got a qualitative result. We were able to determine if Wolbachia was present in the sample and if we were able to successfully amplify the arthropod barcoding gene. If you got a single nice clear band on your gel, you're able to send your PCR products off for sequencing. How does sequencing work? We use Sanger sequencing to determine the order, or sequence, of the nucleotides that make up DNA. Sanger sequencing actually works similarly to PCR, except there are some special nucleotides with some markers on them that are added to the PCR mix. So what goes into a sequencing reaction? We have our TAC polymerase, the DNA we want to amplify, normal nucleotides, special nucleotides with a marker attached to them, and a single primer. This is where it's a little bit different than PCR with the single primer. We're interested in finding out the sequence of the DNA and not in amplifying our product, which is why we only use a single primer. TAC polymerase goes along, adding nucleotides that are complementary to the template strand of DNA until it uses a labeled nucleotide. At that point, extension stops because nothing can be added after that labeled nucleotide. This process repeats over and over and over until you have a bunch of fragments with labeled nucleotides on the end. A few decades ago, you would then run all of these fragments out on a gel and painstakingly decode what your sequence was. Today's Sanger sequencing uses nucleotides that use a fluorescent marker. So you can imagine a fragment of DNA that ends with an A would fluoresce green, that ends with a C would fluoresce blue, and so on. A sequencing machine uses a laser to read the tagged nucleotides and is able to compile all of that information to generate a sequence. A sequence run that uses fluorophores generates a result like this. This chart is called a chromatogram, and it's a lot like the gels that scientists used to run. When the peaks are tall and defined like this, that's a great sign. It means there's a clear and defined signal, kind of like having a nice bright band on a gel. But what's happening here? The sequencer is picking up two or more fluorophores, which means that it's reading multiple different nucleotides at that location. It's common to have some messy sequencing at the beginning and end of your runs for technical reasons. But there are also some biological reasons your sequencing could be messy as well. You can get messy sequencing if you have more than one DNA strand in your sequencing run. For example, some arthropods can be hosts to other arthropod parasites. A really common example of this is when an arthropod is infected by mites. In that case, the sequencing would show results from two separate strands of DNA, the arthropod and the mite, and it would show those results at the same time, resulting in a messy sequence. That's also why it's important to run forward and reverse reactions separately for sequencing, so that you are always analyzing the results of a single strand of DNA. The peaks on your chromatogram are how you can tell if you have a good quality sequence or not. In programs like SnapGene, there's a quantitative measurement called quality score to measure this. We recommend a cutoff of around 40. Either way, you want to make sure that you're working with quality data. The chromatogram with the raw data in it can be found with file formats SCF or AB1. If you're on a Chromebook, don't have access to SnapGene, or only able to view the nucleotides, you'll be able to open file formats Seq or FASTA. These are plain text files that only contain the sequence. You will not be able to investigate the quality of the sequence. Now that you have your clean DNA sequence, you can start your detective work to determine exactly what genus and species your arthropod belongs to by comparing the barcoding sequence to an international scientific database. We can compare this as well with the Wolbachia sequence if your arthropod had Wolbachia. To do this, we'll use a program called BLAST. You can find detailed instructions of how to clean your DNA sequence and how to use BLAST on our website, vu.edu/Wolbachia. I'll see you there.